You're on Meet the Press. After two cancellations, US President Barack Obama arrives on Wednesday, and the visit is set to outdo Kim Kardashian's for excitement. It should be a boost for the Prime Minister. The two leaders seem to get on like a house on fire. They both have their fair share of domestic political problems to deal with. Our next guest knows the President well. As a special advisor, he oversaw the successful implementation of the $787 billion American Recovery and Reinvestment Act. Ed DeSeve is in Australia as a guest lecturer at the ANU's Crawford School of Economics and Government. And it's welcome to the program, Mr. DeSeve. Good morning.
Good morning, Paul. Thank you for having me.
Now, President Obama, it seems, chose Hawaii for the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation Summit. Apparently, the theme he will be going to in his speech to the Parliament on Thursday will be the importance of the Asia-Pacific. Now, is this about containment of China, or does America, in your view, genuinely see that Asia is the growth area of the future, the economic powerhouse of the future?
Well, I'd like to, I think, quote your Prime Minister, the fact that she has a friend in China and also a friend in the United States is very important. The President is from Hawaii. He sees Hawaii as his home, or his natal home, his birth home. And I think what he's indicated is that the importance of the Chinese economy is also balanced by the importance of the economies throughout the region, that Australia and the other partners in Asia are terribly important to the United States, that we are a Pacific nation, not just an Atlantic nation.
The news overnight of apparent progress on the Trans-Pacific Partnership Trade Agreement will help, of course, President Obama make his case to the American audience that this trip is about trade, investment and new jobs for Americans. But my question to you, Mr. DeSeve, is there any point pursuing this agreement when you have only the most tepid embrace from the Japanese Prime Minister, whom we heard say who would continue to protect what needed to be protected, and no buy-in at all from the great growth powerhouse of the region, China? Is there any point to this deal?
I think there is, and I think you have to start somewhere. You start with your friends, the people who have stood by you for many, many years, and then try to convince people who are perhaps skeptical about the transaction that it's in their interest, as well as the interest of all in the Asia-Pacific region.
But with one of the oldest friends, of course, post-war is Japan, which is notoriously protectionist and has indicated only the most lukewarm embrace of this deal. Does this not suggest that the whole thing is just a cover for the collapse of the global round, which the US and others were not able to deliver, the Doha round?
One can't stop, I think the President has said it well, one can't stop trying to advance the goals of the global economy and also trying to advance the goals of the United States to continue to create jobs, to move jobs forward. So anything that he can do or the United States government can do is very important. And so I don't see this as simply a sideshow, if you will. I don't see that at all.
Ed, talking about jobs, the $787 billion stimulus package seems to have failed in terms of jobs delivery. Unemployment stuck at an incredibly high 9%. Can President Obama, what are his chances of being re-elected if unemployment doesn't start to come down?
Well, I think the current polls would show that it's a dead heat between the President and any Republican candidate, and that includes Governor Romney and others. So I don't know that the mandate, if you will, is solely on jobs. Certainly the economy is the President's primary goal. He talks each day about the importance of putting the Jobs Act on the book, a new stimulus program that's very targeted at employment issues. So I think the President has a good chance, a very good chance, of winning re-election. At the same time, jobs are tremendously important along the way.
One of the other great forces for propelling growth and jobs in the U.S. would be if corporate America started to invest the $3 trillion that currently is sitting uninvested and unused on corporate balance sheets. Is that not a vote of no confidence in the political leadership of the U.S.?
I don't think so. I think we're in a time of global uncertainty. What we see happening in Europe, what we see happening in Italy and in Greece and so on, is really a reflection of the need to have global financial reform, which the president has spearheaded. So I don't know that the American corporations, whose profitability is quite good, have turned their back on the United States, but rather they're wary, and they're appropriately wary to make sure that the overall economic change that we see around the globe is going to be good for their business before they make investments.
Coming back to your stimulus program, given that the jobs haven't been created yet, is there a school of thought that says the stimulus was too small, even though it's such a huge amount of money?
Well, more than 3.5 million jobs were created as a result of the stimulus program. That's audited by various parties. So it wasn't that it wasn't a success. It's just that the problem was perhaps worse than anyone knew. And I think that the continuing focus by the president on additional requirements, whether it's jobs for veterans or whether it's various kinds of tax credits, is very important for the continuing reduction of unemployment and stimulation of employment.
Ed, we're just about out of time. There's a lot of excitement in Australia for the visit of the president. Is there any way, do you think, in America that he can regenerate that sort of excitement with his own voters?
I think if you follow the president around the United States, you'll see that that excitement exists. The excitement exists in small towns, the excitement exists in big cities. As the president talks about the agenda that he has and is continuing to have in the United States. Okay. So I don't think there's a lack of excitement.
Thank you very much for joining us today, Ed DeSeve. And thanks to our panel, Fran Kelly and Peter Harcher. A transcript and a replay of this program will be on our website. Until next week, goodbye.